So on the board, last time we kind of got into the temperature composition diagram, so we'll focus on that today. We'll make the change from the pressure composition or PX phase diagram to the TX phase diagrams today. And then we'll really discuss distillation, because the TX phase diagram is really useful for understanding the process of distillation. And then it's required, really, for understanding azeotropic behavior in a situation where you can't fractionally distill one substance from another. So in organic, y'all use fractional distillation to separate compounds with boiling points, so we're a little bit close. You can use simple distillation if the boiling points are far enough apart, because if you just warm it up slowly, that most volatile compound will distill over, and you'll still get a better distillation if you use fractional distillation. We'll talk about that why. Talk about why today. So let's focus on the old phase diagram that we were talking about for a couple of lectures, and that is the pressure. So look at the y-axis pressure composition phase diagram. At low pressures, you have vapor. At high pressures, you have liquid. At intermediate pressures, you have two phases in equilibrium. All the way over here to the right, for substance A, that's 100% A, that's going to be the saturation pressure for that substance, the vapor pressure of that substance at 298 or 1.5 Kelvin. So that's the vapor pressure of the pure substance at that temperature. Over here is the vapor pressure for substance B. And so at that temperature, it has a pure vapor pressure there. And intermediate compositions have vapor pressures in between those two limits. Now, there's two lines on here. One is indicating the composition of the liquid. The other is indicating the composition of the vapor. And so whenever whenever the substance, this mixture is boiling, so here's one atmosphere pressure, so the liquid boils at this composition. So I would go to on this particular plot, the black line, and find that composition, and that composition has a boiling point of 298.15. So think about that phrase. That composition, and only that composition, has a boiling point at room temperature. If I have a composition that is rich in B, so I have more B than that composition, then it would boil sooner. No, if I had a rich in A, because A has a higher pressure. So, you know, this has a higher pressure, it would boil sooner than, or at a lower temperature. This one would boil at a higher temperature. So we could change the temperature and watch where the compositions pass one atmosphere, and we could map out a whole different phase diagram that is at one atmosphere pressure and has a bunch of temperatures. So this one over here shows when pressure is one atmosphere, these are all the temperatures. So this is a temperature composition phase diagram. And so over here on the left side is pure B, and that's the boiling point of pure B. And over here on the right is pure A, and that's the boiling point of pure A. Because all of these have a pressure of one atmosphere. So this is the temperature at which pure A has a one atmosphere pressure, so it's boiling. This is the temperature at which pure B has a pressure, vapor pressure of one atmosphere, so B is boiling. And these are intermediate temperatures. And so what are your reactions to this? I just want to make sure that as you look at this, surely you have some questions or some things that you're curious about. So now's the time to ask. Yes?
Okay, so when we're looking at the PX diagram, mm-hmm. You kind of said something that kind of made me think that it's somewhat decently safe to assume that the kind of the higher the pressure, the lower the boiling point.
Yes.
Correct?
That is a good thing to know. If you have a higher vapor pressure, you have a lower boiling point. And look at the two diagrams. Right. Use these diagrams to support that issue. Can you do that? Anybody? Can you look at this diagram and sort of confirm that principle that the higher the vapor pressure, the lower the boiling point? Mm-hmm. How can you do that?
Well, like pure A, you can see by the vapor pressure, it's
more volatile, so wouldn't it be lower?
Yes. Yeah, so you can see here's the lower boiling point, that's the higher vapor pressure. And so those things with higher vapor pressure boil sooner, boil at lower temperatures. I keep using time. I really shouldn't use time, I should just use temperature, but not sooner. I mean, I guess they're heating things up. But I'm saying that boil at lower temperatures if they have a higher vapor pressure. Because what is boiling? Boiling is when the vapor pressure equals one atmosphere. Okay? And so if it has a higher vapor pressure, it's going to reach one atmosphere at lower temperatures. And I think in all of these phase diagrams, a useful principle is always to go to the limits and try to understand the pure behavior, the behavior of the pure substances. And don't be confused by the x-axis. This is substance A. So over here is pure A. And substance B is pure over here. So it's always A mixed in B or B mixed in A. So you just look at it and see what substance we're talking about. We're just using generic terms now, A and B. So we have two substances mixed together. I prefer temperature composition phase diagrams, and so you'll see more of those moving forward. But I'll show the pressure just to show you. Now, where would Z be in all of this? Well, we might have Z in the middle here and say that this is the, right here, this would be the overall composition. And if we somehow get it above its boiling point, then we're in a pressurized vessel that holds it at one atmosphere. We have, if my overall composition in the beaker, in the sealed container, is right here, then I have 50% of my moles are in the vapor phase, and 50% of my moles are in the liquid phase, if I'm right in between those two. So that's where Z figures into all of this. X is the liquid phase composition, Y is the vapor phase composition, and Z is overall in the whole container, containing the moles of gas and the moles of liquid.
Yes. So quick question, I want to make sure I understand this right. So the reason our YA is at a higher position than XA, which is the, and those are the molar fractions of A, is because Y is more volatile, and so, or
yeah,
A is volatile, and so it's going to be more in the vapor phase.
Yes, it's represented more in the vapor phase, and that's confirmed in both charts. So over here, A has a higher vapor pressure, and so when it gets into the gas phase, it's going to be a stronger component. It's going to be more abundant, because it has a higher vapor pressure. Higher vapor pressure means lower boiling point, right? And so it has the lower boiling point. So when I vaporize it, A is going to be more abundant in the vapor phase. In both cases, the lower boiler is more abundant, the higher vapor pressure is more abundant. Because when things leave the surface, the things with the more vapor pressure are going to leave sooner. Things with the lower boiling point are going to leave sooner and leave at lower temperatures and be more concentrated in the vapor phase. So look at the limits. This has the lowest boiling point. So if you didn't have these labeled with color, if this is the lower boiling point, and you see this curve over here, and if you just draw a line straight across, you would know that the lower boiler is going to be abundant in the vapor phase. You know that this is the vapor phase line, and this is the liquid phase line. Because this one is to the right of substance A. So substance A is the lower boiling point, and so this is the vapor phase line showing that it's always rich in A, and this is the liquid line. Over here, how might we just determine the two? If we didn't have any color coding on here, we would see that substance A has the higher vapor pressure, and this line would always give a higher concentration for A if you draw a horizontal line across. And so then this has got to be the vapor phase composition, that's got to be the liquid phase composition. See a lot of wrinkled brows, so go ahead and tell me what your response is.
So on that first diagram, so where YA goes up and it kind of intersects with the red line, is that where condensation starts to happen?
Yeah, so let's say we, this is a good experiment to do. So we have a beaker, or let's say a closed container that that is at roughly 50-50, A and B, okay? And we start to pressurize that. How could we do that? Well, we could squeeze the piston down. You know, like we start decreasing the volume, the pressure starts to go up. When we hit this point right here, then we see condensation. And the drop that condenses has that composition. Okay? Because, yeah, because B is less volatile, so it's going to want to condense first, okay, or more abundantly. And so the condensation is abundant in B and has a little bit of A. But let's keep pressing that piston in. We get halfway up here. Now I have the lever rule, which we'll discuss here pretty soon, is sort of the ratio of moles in the whole container. I'm halfway in between. The vapor phase, since it's lost some B preferentially in condensation, the vapor phase actually starts to change. If I draw a line right across here, at this point here, I've got about half of my moles in the vapor phase and they have this composition, and half my moles in the liquid phase and it has that composition. And if I keep squeezing that piston down and shrinking the volume, eventually it all has condensed and now it's all liquid in my container. And it has the same composition I started with because I've gone through the condensation and now I'm all liquid and my container still has the same number of moles of both it had in there. Only in this region in here where you have differential composition in the vapor and liquid phases. So ZA would be right along here and YA and XA would shift like this. And then when it hits here, then there's no more vapor and it goes up again. See it?
Yes.
Yeah, so it's
so glad you asked that.
Yeah,
question.
So we've got ZA here and it happens to equal YA when it hits that point. And then we get a little bit of XA. So these two points then slide along as I shrink the piston. And then when we get to this point, my liquid phase is the same as what was in the container, and I no longer have any vapor, and now I'm just in the liquid and I'm pressing on the liquid. But it's only in this region here where it's interesting. You have two phases in equilibrium. And depending on your volume and your overall pressure, then you get this different ratios of gas and liquid phases. So that's wonderful. I think a few people got it. Did you get it? Kind of following along with the, you pick an intersection point and you've got the various ratios of liquid and gas phases. Can do the same thing over here, only you can raise the temperature and adjust the pressure piston until you maintain it at one atmosphere and work your way up. Let's talk now, if we boil the liquid, we get this vapor, and what if we sort of separate it from the liquid and condense it? So if this vapor condenses, it ends up here. What if we boil that? The vapor will be here, and we condense it, it'll be there. So we could just keep boiling and condensing and separating, and eventually we get pure A out. And so that's distillation. So this is what's going on with distillation. This is a temperature composition curve, a TX curve, which we had in the previous diagram. The blue line here is the vapor phase composition. Now we've just labeled this as pure B on the right, this is pure A on the left. If we started where this dotted line is, that's our liquid composition. It boils. The vapor has this composition, and it travels up the fractional distillation column and then recondenses. Why does it recondense? Well, think about it. Your heat source is down here, so there's a temperature gradient. It's cooler at the top than it is at the bottom. That makes total logical sense. So it reaches a point on the glass where it's cooler and it can condense. And it condenses, and so now this vapor condenses. Now it's a liquid, but it has the same composition, so it comes straight down. So that's the composition of that little drop. Now that drop starts to follow down with gravity and it reaches a hot part of the condensation column, I mean the fractioning column. Essentially that's the boiling temperature of that liquid. So it boils again, and the vapor travels up higher in the column because the vapor has this composition.
and that composition condenses further up at a lower temperature. And then gravity pulls it down, then it re-evaporates, and when it evaporates, it has this composition. And it just keeps dragging, you know, zigzagging down until pure B comes out in this case. And at the top, you'll have a little drop on the thermometer, and it'll be the boiling point of B. It'll be this temperature. And if you take an infrared picture of the distillation column, you'll see a temperature gradient. It'll be really bright down at the bottom and dim at the top. I've got some of those pictures. I need to put them in the notes. So I'll show you those. Now, the difference in boiling points gives you this big gap between the two. So if the boiling points are not that different, you have a narrower gap between the vapor and the liquid composition. And so it might take 5 steps versus 3 steps to get to the pure substance. Now, we call those theoretical plates. Okay. And I had heard in my undergrad that these theoretical plates are related to bubble plates. And I really got upset one time. I went to an ACS talk, and we had a chemical engineer there, and he was talking about industrial fractionation, basically refineries. And he was talking about bubble plates. And I raised my hand and I said, I was told that, you know, in my PChem class that they didn't use bubble plates anymore. And he just shook his head. He said, that's unfortunate. He said, every refinery is filled with them. You know? And so my professor, to his credit, was probably talking about in academic distillation. We don't use them in organic lab. We don't have this elaborate bubble plate glassware anymore. But they definitely use bubble plates in refineries. These are bubble plates. Yes.
I have a question. Okay, it's more of like a semantics question. If you go back to the last slide.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so on the slide before this, where B was on the top because it had a higher boiling point,
yes.
And A was on the bottom
mm-hmm.
because it had a lower boiling point, why did it switch?
It's just from a different source. So this is out of a different book.
Okay.
And so they just, their example showing these two in relation to each other happened to have B on the top.
Okay.
So don't worry, don't get mixed up by...
I just wanted to make sure that
I made
like,
these figures
right.
to compare them side by side.
Okay.
And so it just, you know, it's interchangeable.
Yeah.
And so in this case, we're totally different figure. Just really comparing 3 theoretical plates needed versus 5.
Because your vapor pressure is still the line on the top, mm-hmm. and then your...
Vapor composition.
Composition
is
the
on
one
top,
on top, the liquid composition
is
on the bottom. Okay,
yes.
I just wanted to make sure.
Yeah, very good. Now, sorry for always switching back and forth, but it's just different sources of the figures. So these, again, talking about these theoretical plates, they were saying that you know, you would need 3 bubble plates for this one, 5 bubble plates for that one, but they said it's theoretical because no one uses bubble plates anymore, but they do there. They're still used in refinery separations, and more plates equals better separation. So you can actually compute separation efficiency in terms of the efficiency of these bubble plates to separate different boiling points. And so they do this in instrumental analysis. Did y'all talk about this in chromatography? Think back to your GC and your resolution numbers. When you're studying gas chromatography, no? You're talking about theoretical plates?
We talked about theoretical plates.
That's what this is talking about. Same kind of thing. The theoretical plate is a theoretical bubble plate. And so for fractional distillation, you might have a really difficult time separating something that has a boiling point difference of, say, 5 or 10 degrees Celsius. That's pretty easy to do in gas chromatography. In GC, you can have essentially... Some numbers are in the thousands of theoretical plates separation. So it would be as if your fractioning column had 1,000 bubble plates in it, and you could separate things that had 1/10 of a degree difference in their boiling points. Yeah, so exactly, high resolution. Now you can't put a lot of compound through that, so you wouldn't use that for a refinery. Use gas chromatography to separate crude oil. I mean, you get pure hexane in your tank. Not even isohexane or methyl pentane. It's hexane normal. You know, so you could do that, but you wouldn't get very much throughput. You know, so they don't use that high resolution separation. They're just looking for getting fractions out. So
you know, refinery has this enormous heat source. They put the crude oil in, and then everything's separated in terms of their fractions. And you have little taps here that pull off the gasoline and so on. This is a picture of a bubble plate. You have all these little metal caps. And so this is, you know, welded down onto the base plate. You have this hole here where vapor comes up, and it has to go down in the liquid to come out through these little slots. And so this is the bubble cap, because bubbles come out of those slots. So now taking this and looking here, this is the bubble cap. So the vapor goes up and then down through the liquid and bubbles out. So that puts the vapor in contact with the liquid. And so that helps it come to sort of a vapor-liquid equilibrium. And then if the vapor still has a high vapor pressure, it will continue up to the next bubble cap. But if it mixes with that liquid and says, yeah, I like it here, then it stays liquid and you get a good separation. So the volatile stuff continues up, liquid condenses, and you collect a lot of liquid, but if you got too much, then it will flow down to here, flows down here, and this is too hot for that liquid, it'll evaporate and go back up to that layer. But if it's not too hot, it'll stay. And if it's, you know, this collects quite a bit, and this happens to be the boiling point of kerosene, then you can pull a tap off of there and you can have kerosene here. If this is the boiling point range for gasoline, then you pull the tap off and get gasoline. So that's what these really tall columns are with all the pipes coming out of the sides at a refinery. When you drive by a refinery, that's what you see. And it looks like this. Okay, this really tall thing with lots of pipes coming off. Now this is a graphic I got on LinkedIn. I was like, I'm totally stealing this graphic. And he said, sure, go for it. But it was an oil and gas company. This is called Rig Source down here. And they're just sort of promoting, I mean, that's, again, it's an oil and gas company, so they're promoting all of the products that come from oil and gas. I'm here just showing you all the different boiling point ranges. So let's zoom in. The top three in this thing are less than 85 degrees Fahrenheit. Those are your refinery gases. So propane, butane, natural gas that's trapped in the crude oil and so on, comes off the top. We use those to make all kinds of products. I mean, they're trying to stretch it here. Used in antibiotics. Well, anesthetics and propane, polypropylene, and propane are used for the plastics like Tupperware and so on. But a lot of it we just use for liquid propane gas. This 85 to 185 Fahrenheit range are the blending components for gasoline. So it goes into gasoline. Some of those are oxygenates, which is kind of a strange word, but it sort of captures all of the functional groups that have oxygen in them. So aldehydes, ketones, carboxylic acids, and alcohols. And so they'll use those, like phenol as an example. Then you have 185 to 350 Fahrenheit that would be called naphtha, which is the light and heavy paraffins. So those go into waxes, wax paper, candles, etc. Then going down, see how the temperature gradient down here, we're, you know, greater than 1,000 degrees Fahrenheit. It's pretty hot. Okay. So 350 to 450 is kerosene, 450 to 650 is diesel. Then we get into oils, so lubricating oils, and then residual fuel oil, which can be burned in special burners like for ships and so on. Some power plants use oil, and then residue, which goes into heavy tars like our road base materials. So we use everything that we can out of a barrel of crude. So, but I thought this was a really good graphic showing you the different fractional temperature zones for the different fuels and stuff. Questions, reactions? I thought it was pretty cool. Still though, this is fractional distillation. This is called a fractioning column. But now you know why when people say, what's the molecular formula for gasoline? Yeah, it's a range. I mean, what is it? You know, it's a range from 85 to 185 degrees Fahrenheit. So anything that boils in that range is going to be in gasoline. Yeah. So it's a wide range of materials. So it's hundreds of compounds. Same with kerosene and so on.
Wow.
What?
What it says underneath the gasoline tab.
Okay, let me go back.
How many gallons of gasoline you get out of a barrel.
Oh yeah, 16 gallons per 42-gallon barrel, so...
Less than half.
Less than half, yeah. Because you also have the diesel in there as well. So let's see what it says for diesel. Does it say?
10 gallons
out of 42 gallons. So we're up to 29. Yeah. It doesn't really say for lubricating oils. And then they have a lot of things like this residue that they cook. It makes like a coal. It's called coke. And then they can put reactants in there and get a few more light fractions. So they crack the molecules and make them smaller. So a catalytic cracker is called a cap cracker. So they'll put that catalyst in there to break up some of these heavy oils and make lighter fractions because gasoline is more valuable. And so if they put in, you know, some sort of catalytic reactant mix that gets more gasoline out of these heavy fractions, then they get more high-value product. Now, Wilkinson's catalyst, which I learned when I was in inorganic, advanced inorganic, we were talking about rhodium catalyst and so on, and we had the textbook, Cotman-Wilkinson's inorganic chemistry textbook. Wilkinson won the Nobel Prize for this catalyst that got 1 or 2% more gasoline out of a barrel of oil. 1 or 2%, but it's worth billions of dollars worldwide. 1 or 2%. So that's incredible to think about. You can improve a process 1% and make $1 billion difference. So Nobel Prize worthy, you know. So let's look at some now more troubling phase diagrams. Some substances can't be separated by fractional distillation. So you mix them together and they come out as a mixture. They can't come out as a pure substance. And this is seen as a problem in some instances, but in my situation for cleaning, this is a solution. This is something I'm looking for. It's called azeotropes. Okay. Now here's the definition of an azeotrope. It's a solution whose liquid and vapor composition are the same. So notice in all of these previous ones, these previous diagrams, the vapor and the liquid composition were never the same for any of the mixtures. They were only the same for pure substances. Okay? So if ever there was a place where these two lines pinched together, then it would have an azeotrope. So the vapor and the liquid composition are the same for an azeotrope. And that's just the basic definition. Anytime that liquid and vapor composition line touches in the mixture region, not of the pure substances, but in the mixture region, then it's called an azeotrope. And it typically happens that that azeotrope will have a higher boiling point or a lower boiling point than either of the pure substances. So they actually happen to touch up here where the azeotrope has a higher boiling point. So this is an azeotrope because the black and blue lines touch. The black line is the liquid composition, the blue line is the vapor composition, and they're the same value right there. At all other places, they're not. And so you can think of this as simply two different temperature composition phase diagrams. If you just break this chart to the left, you have a TX phase diagram, where this is one substance, and this is the azeotrope. And then if you look on the right, you have a TX phase diagram where you have the azeotrope and a pure substance. And so you could fractionally distill this on this side. Let's start here at A, and I boil A. What's the vapor composition? So this, we're talking about the mole fraction of A. So over here is pure A, and over on the left is the azeotrope. Okay. So I boil this, and this is the vapor composition. And it condenses in the fraction column, and it's very close to pure A. If that boils again and condenses, I have pure A. So if I start right here at composition A2, and I do a fractional distillation, the little liquid drop of my thermometer will be the boiling point of pure A, and I'll collect pure A until I pull enough A off that the pot has this composition. So the pot composition goes uphill, the condensate goes downhill. So you can write that down.
the pot composition moves uphill in terms of a Tx phase diagram, and the condensate moves downhill. So that's the same thing we were seeing way back here, is the condensate is what we were talking about. This will be the condensate. But if I keep boiling, I collect all of the B. What happens to my pot? What's down in the boiling flask? It's moving to pure A. Eventually, I have pure A in the pot and pure B in the condensate flask. So the pot moves uphill. As I pull, in this case, B, as I pull B off, the pot has to get rich in A until it's pure A. But it's not pure A because it's in the pot and pots are dirty. Okay? So you can't get a pure pot. Ever. You would never say, okay, I've separated all of B, what's left is pure A. No, it's A and your boiling chips and any kind of gunk that was in the pot beforehand, or if it decomposed because of the heat, then you're going to have residue decomposition products. You're going to have nasty stuff in the pot. And that's why there's actually a waste class called still bottoms. So when you're doing a distillation, you've got a still, and the pot is the bottom of the still. And you can boil it down, but eventually you can dispose of that, and it's classified as what's called still bottoms. Not a pure substance, it's a gunky mix. So that's a sad thing that you can't use that pot as pure substance, because you think, okay, great, I've got A and B. I can pull B off, I'm left with A. I've got B in this flask, A in this flask. Okay, but no, A is in my still bottom, and so it could have other residue. Now maybe it's a really clean still, it's mostly A, 98% A, but it's not, you can't assume it's 100% A. You can distill B because it has a lower boiling point. So how would I get A out of that? Well, I put in C. It has a higher boiling point than A, and then distill A over. And then C is something I really don't want. And so I send C off of my boiling with my pot, my still bottom. So, but you gotta do two distillations. You gotta distill B off, and then you can mix in another component and distill A.
Are you saying pot?
Pot. Yeah, so the pot. That's just what they call the bottom. Yeah, it's the round bottom flask down in the bottom. Yeah, and that's the pot. Yeah, the still bottom.
I'm envisioning the way the pot looks when I boil water and then forget I'm boiling water.
Yeah. So that can happen. So sometimes the still bottoms get discolored. You start with a beautiful, clean, colorless, you know, solvent. You know, no hint of color at all. It's clear, and you do this fractional distillation. And you get a beautiful, clear, colorless condensate or distillate, and you look in the pot and it's a little yellow now. Well, you've been putting a lot of joules of heat into that substance, and some decomposition has occurred. You never want to distill that to dryness, because especially with things like ethers, it can form peroxides. And ethers, I don't know what the reaction is, but they can join together and make peroxides, and those can detonate. Organic peroxides can detonate if they're dry. Back to our original discussion, if you have an explosive compound and it's wet, it can dissipate the shock sensitivity, you know, it can dissipate mechanical shock. But if you distill that pot down to dryness and you have peroxides in there to blow it, and there's lab accidents all the time in universities where people are doing a distillation to purify solvent and reclaim solvent, they go to lunch, they come back and it's gone dry. Turn the heat off, they're trying to be safe. Then when they go to disconnect the glassware, there's little crystals of peroxide in the ground glass joint, and it blows up in their hands. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So it's good to reclaim solvent, but it's really bad to do it to dryness. You can also check to see if there are peroxides in your still bottom with these little peroxide test strips. And so you just tape one to a really long a coat hanger, run it down the column, pull it out, you're like, oh, it's pink, we got peroxides. Pour in some ether or whatever, pour in some solvent to get that all dissolved up and deal with it. Yeah, there's procedures for how to deal with it. But let's, coming back to this, you see how now we kind of have two phase diagrams. We have the phase diagram to the left
of the azeotrope and the phase diagram to the right of the azeotrope. Now, if my composition is to the right of the azeotrope, look at the x-axis. What's being plotted? In this case, it's the mole fraction of A. So if I'm to the right of the azeotrope, I'm rich in A. You understand my term? I'm rich in A compared to the azeotrope. I have more A than I need. And so I could distill that excess A off and give. And the pot's going to approach the azeotropic composition because it's a high boiler. Okay. If I'm to the left in this particular plot of the azeotrope, I'm rich in B because I'm plotting A on the x-axis. So I don't have enough A. I'm poor in A or rich in B. I could distill B off, and the pot would approach the azeotropic composition. Okay. But I can't get the azeotrope out of this one in a pure state because it's always going to be in the pot because it always has a high boiling. But what if the azeotrope was a low boiler? That could happen too. Maybe the azeotropic composition is down here. So let's look at that situation. On this, and this is the example of water and ethanol. The water ethanol azeotrope is the lowest boiling point mixture in the pot. So I can't separate pure ethanol away from water. I can get it's like 95% ethanol and 5% water. But I'm always going to get that out of a distillation. I'm never going to get pure dry ethanol. It's always going to be wet because there's a water ethanol azeotrope. And it's the lowest boiling point in the whole pot. So whether I'm rich in this particular point A, if I do a fractional distillation, I get the azeotrope. Because the condensate rolls downhill, the pot goes uphill. If I'm over on this side, I'm rich in B, and I do a fractional distillation, the condensate rolls downhill, I get the azeotrope. No matter where I am in this diagram, the condensate is going to be the azeotrope. Do you see that? Because it's rolling downhill. The pot rolls uphill, moves uphill. So if I'm over here and I keep distilling, the azeotrope is going to be collected, and the pot's going to move more towards, in this case, substance A. This would be water in this particular example. Or if I'm rich in ethanol, I can distill, I get the azeotrope, and the pot's going to move more towards pure ethanol. And you say, aha, we get pure ethanol, right? No, it's in the pot. So it's not pure ethanol. It's ethanol and everything that doesn't want to boil. Boiling chips and grease. So I wouldn't drink that. Now this ethanol and water, you can drink that, and that's Everclear, it's wet alcohol. I mean, they say it's 100%, but it's the azeotrope. It's going to be the azeotrope. And to keep students from drinking the ethanol in the lab, they have denatured ethanol, but it's not from water, it's from some other organic solvent. So there's minuscule amounts of some other organic solvent which you don't want to drink. Okay. Yeah. Just FYI. So, and we always scare people. It's like it's denatured from benzene. So they mixed it with benzene and they distilled it off, you know, just to scare people. Like, ooh, there's benzene in there. I don't know what it's distilled from. A lot of times it's denatured from methanol. So you don't want to drink methanol. So it'll be ethanol with a small amount of methanol in it, but it'll be dry. So if you're doing an organic reaction somehow in alcohol, but you want it to be dry, then you don't want to distill it from water because you can't get all the water out. You could distill it from some other solvent and get dried ethanol, and if your reaction is water sensitive, that's good, but you're going to have residual amounts of that other solvent. Any questions? This is really good because what we do in my research is we try to blend a good organic solvent that's good for dissolving grease in with an azeotrope, make an azeotrope with a flame retardant. So a lot of halogenated solvents So a lot of the halogenated solvents are really good flame retardants because it takes a lot of energy to break the carbon and fluorine bond, for example. And so we'll mix in fluorinated compounds with an organic solvent, try to make an azeotrope that is a low boiler.
So that the vapor zone is rich in that azeotrope, and that azeotrope is non-flammable. So whenever we're doing vapor degreasing, we're constantly boiling the solvent mixture, and it has a vapor blanket that you put the part in. And that vapor condenses on the part, and it's pure vapor, so it's very clean. It grabs hold of the grease and drives it off the part. So it condenses on the part because the part's cool, it's at room temperature, and so it drags the grease and oil and particles and everything off of the part, and you never stick the part into the dirty solvent. And all the grease sits in the sun, but the pure, beautiful, azeotropic mixture keeps evaporating. There's cooling coils around there, so it sets up this vapor zone. And you can actually see it happen. I mean, you have a dry part, dry part, dry part. You put it below this vapor zone, which you really can't see, and all of a sudden it gets wet. You see it just start dripping. It looks like it's sweating. And the grease is dripping off and coming off, and then you pull it off. And there's also these cooling coils, which solvent is condensing on too. They run around a little track and go into this little pure solvent sump that has ultrasonic driving transducers in it. And so then that's a pure pot of clean solvent. You dip your part in there and turn on the ultrasound. And it knocks off any adherent soils. And then you pull it back up, and typically this sump is not heated, so that's a cold bath with ultrasound. And then you put it back in the vapor zone and give it a nice rinse with freshly distilled vapor. You pull it out, the part's hot. You have a separate set of cooling coils up here, which the vapor just flashes off the part and goes to these cooling coils. You pull it out dry. It's fantastic. So we took like 20 minutes of cleaning these parts by hand with hexane and wiping the grease off. We thought that was a good baseline. We weighed them. We put grease on. We stuck them in the vapor degreaser with trichloroethylene. Another time we did it with impropyl bromide. These are two common solvents. And they came out cleaner than what we could get them in our baseline. So they weighed less. I mean, it was amazing. They got 101% clean. And we did it in like 5 minutes. So you can spend 20 minutes of rubbing with a degreasing solvent, or you can put them in this vapor degreaser for 5 minutes. Pull it out, clean and dry. So it's really a fantastic technology. But you can't put a flammable solvent in there because you've got a vapor zone that's explosive. So if there's a ignition source or anything like that, you can blow up the place it gets. So we use this azeotropy to find a non-flammable mixture that can be constantly boiled and not separated. So we're actually using azeotropes for our benefit in those situations. There's all kinds of azeotropes. This is a figure out of the CRC handbook. The ones we've talked about, let's just look at the TX diagrams. We looked at the low boiling azeotrope, and then we looked at the high boiling azeotrope. But this is a weird one. This is a low boiling where the liquid is two phase. So there's actually phase separation in the liquid phase. Here's a low boiling, partially miscible, so there's two phases in the liquid phase in this composition range, but over here you have a homogeneous range. So we'll talk about this partial miscibility next time. This is a weird one, a double azeotrope. At this composition you have a high boiler, at this composition you have a low boiler. So that is weird. In between, the pot would move towards the high boiling azeotrope, the condensate would be the low boiling azeotrope. So you can never, in this range, get any of the pure substances out as a condensate. And then here's a high boiling, partially miscible. So this partial miscibility, we'll talk about next time, where you have two phases in the liquid, like oil and water. So, a little foreshadowing. And then next time we'll also get into the solid phase diagram.